Andrea's first time in person, so you better put on the show.
I'm ready.
Buckle up, girl. All right.
Ready?
Mad Dog?
Mm-hmm.
I'm ready. I'm ready.
You got three for us?
You mean, see Steve? Yeah, there we go. Okay.
Hey,
Steve.
One.
Right here.
Number one, how about Kirk Cousins being somewhat perturbed that Atlanta drafted Michael Penix with the 9th pick in the first round last week? Kirk Cousins, you're getting paid $50 million a year guaranteed. You've won one playoff game in your life, and you are not a longtime Falcon. You're not Tommy Nobis. You're not a longtime Falcon who deserved respect and sort of a heads up that this is where the Falcons are going to go. I love the Falcons pick. I think Penix is going to be great. And to me, they got themselves organized for the next 17, 18 years. And here's Cousins, who left Minnesota a better organization, who left the best receiver in football, who left a tremendous offensive coach in O'Connell in a great division to bail, to go to Atlanta that has not been a great historical organization, that has only been around since 1966, and has never won a thing. And by the way, is the third biggest team in that town behind Georgia football and the Braves. And now I gotta wonder, I understand he called Penix late at night to say, hey, welcome. But now I gotta read and hear that Cousins was perplexed and couldn't believe it, that he didn't draft somebody for immediate help, and they instead went for a backup quarterback. Who cares what Kirk Cousins thinks? You got $90 million guaranteed, and you've won one playoff game in your life. You know what you do if you're Kirk Cousins? You get your butt to Atlanta as far as training camp is concerned. You play great football, and you make sure Penix can't play because you're playing so damn well. And I'll tell you something else you do if you're such a great. If somebody walked into my radio station thinking that he was the heir apparent, you know what I do? I teach him everything about radio because he ain't going to be better than me.
Whoa! Ooh. Hey!
Same thing
with Cousins. That's what I'm talking about, my guy.
That's a word.
Andrea's from Atlanta.
Yes, please, just keep going.
A little bit longer.
I am very, very proud of that tape. Little bravado there at the end. Hall of Fame stature, reminding them of who the hell you are.
Yep.
Not bad, doggy. That's one of your best moments, my brother.
That was a good one. And honestly, don't quote me on this, but I think he's made like $250 million.
With one win.
No, it's 294.
With one postseason win, and I'm a guy who supports Cousins on this show, number two.
Yeah, okay, let's get it.
This bothered me here this week with Aaron Judge, you know, who basically played Marvin Webster, the human eraser, on this ground ball in the extra innings against Milwaukee. It was in the sixth inning against Milwaukee the day. This is on Sunday afternoon. The game is tied. Watch Judge put his hand up to block the ball out of the way, and the umpire said, we blew it. He made a mistake. Look at this. I mean, he put his hand 9 miles in the air, and look at that. Hey, you don't tell it. And then he said after the game, I was my normal slot. I wasn't trying to block. Nonsense. You were trying to basically block the shot, and he did it with a mitt on, with a mitt. How about if Judge takes the glove off and does it with his bare hand and breaks his left hand and is out 6 weeks? And the Yankees made such a big deal. Our umpires got it right. Perfect call. Nonsense. That was a bush move by Judge, who I love. That kind of slide is not necessary. And the umpires themselves after the game said, you know, we blew it. We should have caught an obstruction. And then the Yankees wouldn't have won. The game was 4-4. And I cannot believe Judge did that. That is garbage. That is not unnecessary. That is not, that's rinky-dink baseball on that kind of slide. Drove and with a mitt on, so he doesn't hurt himself. Anybody can go up here with a mitt on and bang the ball away. There's no effect with your injury. That drove me crazy, too, number two.
Boy, that's being a phony, okay? That's being a flat-out phony. How much cheating goes on in baseball? The pine tars and the bats and all of this and what pitchers do. Stop it. Stop acting like this stuff is foreign in baseball. He tried the trick. You know what? It worked. It shouldn't have worked. You're right about that stuff like that. Don't give me this Bush League nonsense like, oh, my Lord, let's play to the letter of the law and the rules of the game. When baseball is famous, infamous for breaking rules all the damn time. This is just the latest. Thank God he's not hurt, didn't hurt his hand or anything like that. I don't think that was smart because I need you, Aaron Judge. But let's not overreact and act like he committed some crime against humanity. Stop with your phoniness.
That was a Bush play. You agree?
You're more mad at Aaron Judge or the umpires? Who are you more mad at?
Judge. He should know better.
Okay.
Oh, please.
Take us home.
Number three.
Make it strong.
Number three.
Finish strong, Mad Dog.
Historically, they're an awful NBA town. I tell you right now, what those Sixer fans did on Sunday afternoon, allowing the Knicks fan to run and overtake that arena and make it a home game for the Knicks is an absolute, utter disgrace. And don't tell me they wanted to make their money back from the season ticket thing. These are great seats. Look at this. This was unbelievable on Sunday. And this is big, proud Philadelphia, who's got Embiid and Maxey, who considers himself, you know, almost like a little better version of the Knicks and New York City. That was a disgrace that the Philadelphia sports fan basically vacated their building for a playoff game against New York City when it was 2-1. And I don't want to hear him now tell me about the greatness of New York, Philadelphia with basketball. Go back to 1981. They will never lift this down as far as I can lift. Game 7 of the second round of the NBA playoff series with the Bucks and the Sixers. There's the video. Look at this. That's Bobby Jones. That's Julius Erving. That's Lionel Hollins. That's against the Bucks and Lanier and Bridgman and Dave Myers and Moncrief. That was a tremendous series, and the Sixers won Game 7, 99-98. It was Mother's Day in 81. On Mother's Day, you know what the attendance was? 6,700. You know what the attendance was across the street for Phillies and the Cubs? 35,000. And then Philadelphia does what they do on Sunday afternoon, and all those fans who like to consider themselves great sports fans and sort of anti-New York, they give up their tickets to Knicks fans to make that building, Madison Square Garden South. That was an incredible sports disgrace. And to me, an incredible black eye on Philadelphia sports. Mm. That's number 3.